Have you recovered from Mickey at this point?
Yeah, I actually saw him for the first time in a year, like a couple of weeks ago. It was great. He's in great spirits. He lives in a fat pad. He gave me a suit that didn't fit me, that didn't fit him anymore. I tried to get it fitted, but it didn't fit. It was like a purple sharkskin suit. He's doing great.
You could have done all your interviews in a purple sharkskin
suit. Yeah, exactly.
It would have been perfect.
He's doing great. So it was nice to see him.
So you changed his life again. And now you're changing everybody else's life. This movie is brilliant and insane.
Thank you. Trying.
Is that what you were after? Because it feels to me like it's the ultimate Aronofsky movie. It's both genre and high art at the same time.
Oh, well, thank you. You know, I don't know. You don't go that consciously into it. You just sort of want to make something different and something cool. And you know, we've been developing it for 10 years, and the fact that we kept coming back to it is always a good sign, you know? Mm-hmm. It's kind of a marathon, how we do development at Protozoa, my company. It's all these projects are running, and the ones that get to the finish lines are the ones we come back and help, you know, mm-hmm. give them a new pair of shoes. And there was just always something in this that, you know, intrigued us and brought us back.
So it wasn't just your sister?
No. The sister was she was really good at ballet, and it was just something in the background, and I just thought that it's an interesting world. You know, and the wrestling, I mean, I was into it for a year when I was mm-hmm. 8 or 9 or whatever it was, and so it just was always in the back of my head, the memories of it. And you get a lot of root power from your childhood, you know. You know, Requiem for a Dream we shot in Coney Island where I grew up, and so, you know, a lot of stuff from back then sort of trickles its way into mm-hmm. These ideas.
So this one seems like it really is about more than just the ballet world, even though it's deeply yeah. set in the ballet world.
Yeah.
It seems like any artist trying to get to maturity and to, you know, getting over that yeah. hump.
Yeah, I've had really good responses from actors already because, you know, I think it's about performance and performers, and I think anyone that, you know, goes out there and, you know, make sacrifices for their art can relate to it, or for their work, or for anything, you know, they can relate to it.
So after The Wrestler, did you feel like you had a free pass to do the next thing, or was it easy to get this funded? How did that work out?
This was a nightmare getting funded. I thought after doing, you know, a wrestling picture with Mickey Rourke, that everyone was like, what the hell are you doing? And then it worked out okay, you mm-hmm. know? I thought it would be much, much easier. But this was more difficult to get made than The Wrestler.
What were they saying to you?
Well, you know, I came with a kind of sexy ballet thriller that has genre elements mm-hmm. with a legitimate movie star and Natalie Portman and a great background cast, you know, yeah. an international star like Vincent Cassell and mm-hmm. Mila Kunis and Barbara Hershey and Winona Ryder. I thought it wouldn't be an issue. And once again, it came down to one investor. You know, we had this money set up, and about 4 weeks out, it fell apart. And then we found this company, Cross Creek, 2 weeks out. And then Fox Searchlight literally greenlit the film a day before. So it was really stressful. And of course, they greenlit the film way under budget. And so mm-hmm. it was, every day was a nightmare. You know, the 40 days of shooting was, every day, it was, you know, normally you come to the set, you look at the call sheet, you're like, oh, yeah, okay. And then there's 4 or 5 days that are just a real nightmare. Mm-hmm. Every single day on Black Swan was like, we got to do that? Man, you know, every day was just such an effort. And then, of course, by the time we got the post, we had used up so much of the post money that it mm-hmm. was just, then it became a nightmare in post. So it was it was probably the hardest film to actually execute.
So was 40 days your intention, or was it really wanted to be 60 days and you had to do 40
days? You could always use more time, but we really needed more time. I mean, for instance, the big Swan Lake performance at the end where we actually put on a ballet, for each of those acts of the ballet, we had one day. Mm. One day to shoot. Mm-hmm. And we didn't have a lighting tech. So basically, you know, you're spinning the camera around these actors, but there's a big spotlight mm-hmm. and so what's gonna happen to the shadow? You know, that's going to mm-hmm. come on. So there was all these technical nightmares we had to deal with, which ate up a third of the day. So we basically had 2/3 of a day mm-hmm. to shoot. I mean, normally you would get, if you're doing a production and photographing a production, you would get a full, day to get, you know, get that out of the way mm-hmm. before you even shot. And we didn't get that. So it was tough.
So were you and Libatique very detailed in what you were going into?
I mean, you know, me and Maddie have a really good, division of labor. You know, I'm really interested in the frame, and he's really interested in the light. Mm-hmm. I think he's also good at the frame, but that happens to be one of my big things. Right. And we collaborate with each other mm-hmm. in each other's departments. But he's really, you know, he understands light and film stock and the look, and color a lot more than I do. And I'm really interested in composition. And so it's a really nice collaboration because we can sort of split, you know, those chores.
But people kind of looked at, I guess, the wrestler and figured this would be, you know, loose feeling, like, and more documentary feel than like the wrestler. And it's really anything but.
Yeah. Well, that was a huge discussion that took a really long time because I really enjoyed the cinema verite documentary feel mm-hmm. of the wrestler. I mean, it's not a true documentary because the camera is choreographed with Mickey. So right. normally in a documentary, if Mickey reaches for something, the camera gets there a second later. Mm-hmm. We knew he was going to reach, so we could get there with him. So it was a dance.
Right.
But I really enjoyed doing it. I enjoyed these long takes and following mm-hmm. and, you know, blocking with it. I thought it was a lot of fun. And so when we started to do Black Swan, and I recognized there were similarities between the stories in certain ways that they're both about performance, I was mm-hmm. like, it would be interesting to bring this verite, you know, documentary feel into this, but can we do that in a horror film? Mm-hmm. Because will it destroy the tension if the audience feels suddenly, why doesn't Natalie turn to the cameraman and go, help? You know? So we weren't sure, and we tried to look for a reference, and there really wasn't a reference of a horror mm-hmm. film that was handheld that we could think of. But after a while, I was just kind of like, you know what? It's different, and screw it. And kind of the side of that is the first third we always saw as being very normal. Mm-hmm. And I think the kind of documentary feel makes people think it's very realistic, so it actually helps us when everything really starts to freak out later in the film. Mm. So that was a nice little side effect of going with this kind of doc look.
So, a beautiful film, a lot of beautiful people. It seems like everybody was on it. We've been talking to everybody, that people were on it for 2 years, 4 years, 7 years, that people have been actually connected to this project for a very long time.
Yeah.
It's a very unusual way to cast, I'd say.
Well, it was a very hard film to make, and it ended up making everyone's commitment to stay on it longer and longer and longer. I mean, every time we had a push because the money fell apart or whatever, you know, the hardest conversation to have was with Natalie because I knew it meant, you know, carrot sticks and almonds for another 3 months for her, and she was not going to be happy. But everyone kind of stuck with it, and it took a long time.
But she told us it took since she was 20, really, that you first pitched the film.
We had a conversation almost 10 years ago in the Howard Johnson's in Times Square, which I believe is an American. It's like an American Apparel now or something.
Sadly.
And she tells me I had a lot of the ideas worked out then, you know, but there was barely a script. Mm. But you know, I think the initial terror idea of someone taking over your identity. Mm-hmm. Was there, and that's kind of stuck with it. This idea. Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of other themes in it, but that's mm-hmm. definitely one of them.
Well, one of the themes is tiny brunettes, I think.
Well, that came out of Natalie. I mean, when we cast Natalie, you know, there were a lot of interesting actresses out there that had a lot of dance background that I was very interested in, but I wanted everyone to look like Natalie, so mm-hmm. I really built the entire cast out of what she looks like.
And so are Winona and Barbara more mature Natalie's? Is that the...
Yeah, I think so. I mean, Barbara, you know, was great. She did one of the most, you know, really cool acting things. She actually kind of painted out the bottom corner of her eyebrows here mm-hmm. to make a straighter line to mimic Natalie's kind of iconic. Natalie has those really straight eyebrows. Mm-hmm. And she came in and I was like, wow, you look a lot... And she's like, oh, look what I did. I was like, oh, that's brilliant. It was great. It was her idea. So yeah, I mean, Barbara was great. And I mean, Winona's interesting because she, you know, first she was great because she gave me like this, the second the audience sees her, they know she was a star at mm-hmm. once. So it kind of was this meta casting idea of having someone kind of play the same role as they played and Winona at one point was probably even bigger than Natalie mm-hmm. ever was, but, had as a similar
right.
place in history as Natalie now is having. Mm-hmm. So I thought it was an interesting way that, you know, there was a little meta casting going on.
And do you discuss that with your actresses, or is it too far into their heads?
I don't think I was that clear with Winona. I mean, I you know, there's a lot of challenges, and it takes a lot of bravery for someone like Winona to do a role like that. But, mm-hmm. you know, she came and she was so prepared and she had so much fun with it that it just shows you that, as they say, there are no more roles, just small actors. And she really shines in it, and she's beautiful in it. And it's, I think there's, a new chapter on Winona's starting, because people mm-hmm. really do want to see her and people really like her in this film. And it's nice to be at the front end of it, you know. Mm-hmm.
So where did you first see the film with an audience?
With a real audience, I guess, was the Venice Film Festival. But so that was a very strange audience, because Natalie Portman was on one side and she'd never seen the film, and her parents were right behind her and they'd never seen the film, and you know, there's a decent amount of sexual content. Mm-hmm. And on the other side of me was literally the president of Italy, because it was the opening night at the Venice Film Festival, who was mm-hmm. 82 years old with his 82-year-old wife next to her. And I just leaned over at the beginning and I said, you know, I'm really sorry for what I'm about to do to you. Because, you know, these are really classy people. Mm-hmm. In fact, when they introduced, you know, the president, I mean, it was, it's not that guy who's under scandal.
Right.
It's this honorary president mm-hmm. who was, you know, the applause for this guy mm-hmm. was so long and so endearing. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't really know who he is because I don't know much about Italian politics, but I was like, oh shit, this guy's really respected, and I'm about to, like, you know, slap his wife in the face for an hour and 40 minutes. I was terrified. So I could not tell you what that experience was like. Although we got a nice standing ovation at the end, people liked it. It was a very mm-hmm. strong reaction.
Would you look for laughs? Do you look for sighs? Do you look for screams? What do you?
I've snuck into the back of the theater a few times during some of the scary scenes to see what type of jumps we get.
Mm-hmm.
And it's been interesting because there's a lot of humor in the film that, you know, I knew it was like a funny moment, but I never thought it was out loud laughing. And
right.
I think there's a little release of tension going on, and people just, from the beginning, you know, this is not going to go that well. I mm-hmm. mean, the tone is very clear at the beginning. There's a darkness to it.
Right.
But the laughter is really, people want it. And so, and I'm like, great, have fun. Just know you're going to be in pain in about 45 minutes, and I'm sorry.
Well, I think part of it is uncomfortable laughter, but I think part of it is also, like, there are moments in the movie where I found myself laughing because there was a joy to the fact that certain things were actually happening on the screen.
Oh, cool.
It was almost like you had the balls to do it, and it was like, oh my God, I can't believe he went there. Oh, great. It's like a, you know, happiness that somebody actually did it.
Yeah, you know, look, you know.
The cake.
Yeah.
It's funny. It's crazy, but it's dark and it's important, but it's also.
Yeah. Well, you just want to have fun. And I mean, that's been the best compliments to me, which I keep hearing, which is it's both different and fun.
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of been and that word fun has been such a strange word for a movie. And it keeps coming up, and that's mm-hmm. exciting because it's like, yeah, I mean, you know, we want to go to the films and have a good time, and it's a crazy, wild trip, but it's actually enjoyable. There's a lot of bugged out things, and the thrills keep coming in the film. That's, you know. So
well, did you
I'm
know
happy.
That when you wrote it? Do you know when you're working on the script? Did you know it when you're shooting it? Did you know it in post?
Which part?
The idea that it was also an entertainment.
Yeah, I mean, that's the bottom line. I'm always trying to make entertaining films. Everything I do, I mean, I never want to bore an audience. And so I'm just always trying to keep the thrills coming I'm not making big action films, so thrills is the wrong word, but I'm just trying to keep an audience engaged and interested and curious the whole mm-hmm. time. And I think, you know, if you ever lose that engagement, you're in trouble. So, you know, my mentor, Stuart Rosenberg, had a sign on his desk that said, "Where is your audience now?" And I think that's, you always have to think about that. Where is your audience?
Well, you said they wondered what you were doing trying to make this movie after The Wrestler, and you just said you don't make big action films, but you're making a big action film, and we can't figure out what the hell you're doing.
Well, that's the great thing, is like every time I start a film, everyone's like, "What the hell is he doing?" So hopefully, once again, I'll surprise everyone.
So Darren, what the hell are you doing?
I'm just trying to have fun, and I think for the first time in my life, every single film I've done so far, I've been the only person in the room who wants to make the movie.
Huh.
And I kind of am excited about doing a film where everyone wants to make it. And just to see what the experience is like, and see if I can do what I do in that world, you know? Mm-hmm. And it's not like I'm gonna change my process. I'm gonna be working with the same team
mm-hmm.
and, you know, making, you know, really trying to do something very, very different and see what happens.
So do you make sure that Hugh is on board and that Tom Rothman is on board before you?
Oh, yeah. No, I mean, I've been looking for a situation that where everything lines up really well. And, it just makes sense because everyone, I think I'm being hired because of who I am. I'm not mm-hmm. being hired to be like turn into someone. I'm being hired to do what I do.
So Thomas said, go ahead, be.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know exactly if he knows what he's bought, but, you know, I mean, we're definitely going to make something great, you know, but it will be very different, you know, and that's, you know, what I do. So I'm going to try and have a great time with it.
You're going to find a new way to blow shit up?
There's not too much blowing shit up. You know, I mean, you know.
Don't you have to blow some shit up in Wolverine 2?
I don't know. It's not, by the way, take off the number 2. Nothing to do with that. It's a standalone piece that has nothing to do with anything in the whole franchise or in that universe.
Wolverine colon the Aronofsky years?
The Wolverine.
Just the Wolverine.
Okay. It's the title of the film.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's exciting. I mean, it's fascinating, the idea of doing, the funny thing is that Tom Rothman gets a lot of shit for being, you know, making a lot of some bad movies and making commercial movies and whatever and being very tight on budget, but he takes real chances with some very good directors doing these films that are more commercial. Mm. I mean, he does seem kind of gutsy in a weird way.
He doesn't even know how gutsy it is.
So back to the Swan.
No, we're just going to have fun and make something really fun and entertaining, which is, you know, which I think is possible, you know?
Yeah.
You know?
So what was the hardest challenge for you directing this besides the number of days?
Oh, there were many challenges. I mean, first of all, it's an incredibly athletic film, so the risk of injury was, you know, really substantial, and, you know, Natalie being in every scene was, you know, a big risk. And, you know, we had, you know, in a ballet company every day there's injuries, so we were, you know, you're talking about things that really suck, like, you know, a dancer losing a toenail, which happens and is basically crippling for a while, and it's very painful. And so that whenever you bring athleticism into it, it's really tough. You know, the emotional stuff of the film, which is really extreme, is never an issue. I mean, even on, like, Requiem for a Dream, you know, you're electrocuting Ellen Burstyn, but, she's a professional, and when you call cut, she's Ellen Burstyn, you know, again. So, and all my actors were that way. So, and they were really all delightful, every one of them across the board. I had no problems with any actor, and believe me, I've had problems with actors. But, you know, they were all professionals, and they all wanted to be there, and they all did their job, and take after take after take, they were having a great time. So we were able to get through it. The real problems were just the limit in time, you know, and not having that much support structure. I could have used a little bit more money and a little bit more time, which is always important, but on this one, I really needed a little bit more money and time.
But when push comes to shove, I mean, you got what you got.
You get
so
what you get.
Didn't it work out?
It was funny.
Is there a better movie if you had another 20 days, or is it the same movie, just easier to make?
There's of course, a better movie. There's always a better movie when you have, I mean, at a certain point, there's not. There's a point of diminishing returns where you actually start hurting yourself because you have too much time to second guess yourself and try alternative things and get lost. And you need the kind of, I mean, at least that's what I thrive on, because I've always had that. I mean, I've always had limited amount of time and money, but there's, you know, a sane way to do that and an insane way. And we had a lot of luck because we were able to get enough. But, you know, now that the DVD, they're starting to prepare. Fox is like, oh, can you give us the deleted scenes and stuff? And there's literally no deleted scenes. There's nothing. I mean, there's some scraps and stuff, but they're scraps. I mean, we used everything we shot.
One of the conversations we had with a number of the actors was that they did a lot of scenes. Well, actually, it sounds very much like you told Natalie to make one choice about what was true and what was real for her, and that was her decision, and she did it. And then you told the other actors, you got 3 or 4 different versions of what reality was from the other actors. Is that a reasonable read?
Maybe. I don't remember.
I mean, Barbara and Mila both kind of said, they did it different ways. They each had to give you a bunch of different ways.
Natalie said you
talked about it a lot, and then right before you started shooting, you basically said, make a decision on the day. Whatever the decision is, go with that.
Really?
Yeah.
I'm sure I tried different tones with Natalie as well, mm-hmm. on different things, but which I generally do. I mean, I think a lot of, you know, of course the performance is happening in the moment, but it's nice if you get options to bring back to the edit room, mm-hmm. and get different sort of angles on it, because then you can, you know, it's hard to really know exactly what you're going to need until you get there, and that's the thing you always don't want to be, is when you're in the edit room and you're like, oh, I wish I had her do it that way.
But this is not like a normal movie, really. It's really, the options, I think, are,
absolutely.
Are what's truth and what's not truth.
Yeah, but, and we always wanted to, and I was always, I mean, a big thing I did with, you know, Winona was reminding me, one thing I like to do is like have her do it one way and then switch 180 and mm-hmm. then come back to 180. And it kind of just loosens them up and has mm-hmm. them go in different ways and try different things. And then you get weird kind of, you know, complex flavors, because you never leave behind exactly what you just did. You take a little bit of it with you. Mm-hmm. So, you know.
Did you have a specific answer to all those questions while you were doing it, or did you do it, figure it out in post? Which you thought?
I think we always knew there were, we had a sense of what was real and what wasn't real in every scene. And mm-hmm. and I think that pretty much carried through the following film, but we didn't know exactly how much of the ambiguity we wanted to play at different times. Mm-hmm. So we would add things to make it a little bit more shaky at different times and things. You know, put a little look here, a little look there. You know, I mean, that's, you really do make the film in the edit room. Mm-hmm. That's when you really shape it all together. You know, when you're on the set, you're just collecting as much stuff as you can, and it's sort of, with this type of pressure, you don't have the time. I mean, you know, it's interesting, because it used to be back in the day, you'd have 130 days. You know, in the 70s, you'd have 130 days to make a movie. Mm-hmm. So you didn't have to worry about stuff. You know, today, most of these films are 30, 40 days. And you run into all types. I mean, we do get other advantages, which we have digital editing, so we right. can try a million different things. And also, if you screw up and there's a C-stand in the shot, you know, it's a few hundred dollars to erase right. the C-stand, when back in the day, you lived with the C-stand in the shot. So right. you can make up for stuff, but, you know, there's no sacrifice for time mm-hmm. to really be able to sit there and understand. And that's the unfortunate part of being a director now. It's such a hustle mm-hmm. to get through it. And so you really, and shooting is what we live for, and what we've spend 2 years trying to raise money for, mm-hmm. it's for those, you know, that 20-second take is what, when we're alive and what we're doing, and it's just a shame that we get so little of it, and we're constantly freaking out mm-hmm. about what we got to get done by the day. So it's a really tough time.
A lot of mirror cleanup in this one?
Oh, endless. It's funny, because there was a shot on the cover of the New York Times a few days ago of ABT was in Cuba, mm-hmm. and there was a great picture of the head of ABT, and the first thing I did is looked at the mirror all the way in the back, and I could see the New York Times cameraman's camera up in the air photographing, and I was like, oh, camera removal, $300. No, but I was just like,
yeah, Levity could have been a co-star in the movie, I'm sure, before it's over.
Oh, the camera was... You know, I mean, that was part of the fun of it, was how to make the mirror scares fresh and new, mm-hmm. and how to play with, you know, having the camera there. But there were so many camera cleanups and reflections. I mean, it was endless. But that was one of the fun parts of the film.
Did CG end up playing a big part in your post?
There's 300 visual effects in the film. And I'd say, you know, besides 30 of them, you don't see any of them.
Right.
And there are a lot of little subtle things. And pretty much every single mirror in the film is affected and manipulated mm-hmm. to, you know, either it's one frame off or seven frames off. And it was fun because we were working in a widescreen in 2.35. Mm-hmm. And so where the, you know, you can't really see both sides unless you're really sitting in the far mm-hmm. back of the theater. And it's a, you know, the Zig field or something. Right. Otherwise, you're screwed. And, you know, so I was really playing with stuff, like if you're really looking at Natalie over here, mm-hmm. can we screw around with something over here? Just at it, so peripherally, mm-hmm. you're messing with you. So if you do see it again, don't look exactly where you're supposed to be looking, and you'll see a whole other film.
It is kind of a see-it-again movie. I mean, I guess cool. that's supposed to be a marketing tool, but
in
many ways, this movie, you think, gets richer, and I've seen it twice, and look forward to seeing it again, but, you know, you would think it get richer and richer each time you see it.
Well, you know, and there's also, you know, there's the score is just, I mean, a lot of people, at least myself, I I don't really hear the score when I'm watching a film. I'm so mm-hmm. focused on the drama in general. Mm-hmm. And you know, usually when I see a film a second or third time, that's when I start to become aware of what the music's doing and stuff. Mm-hmm. And this film, the music is so front and center, but you know, there's an incredible score going on because it's Tchaikovsky meets Clint Mansell, and it's a lot of fun. And there's a lot of subtle things. I don't know if in the dance club scene, mm-hmm. When they're on the floor, every single one of those frames is painted, meaning that they're all manipulated. Mm-hmm. And there's a whole world of subliminal shit going on, which I think, you know, will be fun for the Blu-ray crowd.
Mm-hmm. It was reminding me a little bit of, that whole sequence was reminding me a little bit of Jacob's Ladder.
Oh yeah, sure.
And I'm thinking like...
Yeah, with the strobe, yeah. I mean, yeah. I've got a few referrals. It's one of my favorite films, so it's very flattering.
So did you watch The Red Shoes before you embarked?
I did, but not before we were deep in it, because I had heard of it when I started it, but I didn't really pursue it. And then Scorsese's restoration came around. Mm-hmm. I was like, oh no, I better watch this. And then, yeah, of course I saw it.
It's kind of, it felt in some ways to me like this movie is almost like, you know, if you could remake The Red Shoes now, because all the things that he's not allowed to really touch.
Right.
You seem to have dove right into.
What do you mean? The sexuality?
Well, any of the sexuality, the subtext of what this relationships really are about. You know, all the stuff that's going on is much more complex in your film.
Yeah.
And in some ways, there's definitely a reflection.
Yeah. It's interesting. I mean, you know, it's been a lot of years and neorealism and all this different types of movement. So we have a very, very different type of movie. You know, his films, you know, there was a giant 30, I don't even know if it was 35 millimeter camera on it, big sticks and dollies. And we have just a light 60 millimeter camera. But then, you know, he probably had 200 days to shoot that film. And, you know, his visual effects were visionary and probably a decade ahead of their time. Yeah. And so, you know, there's lots of differences. What's interesting, I think, between both films is that they're, you know, he clearly did his research into the ballet world, and we did a lot of research into the ballet world, and similar, you know, tropes and characters arose, because I think the ballet world is the ballet world, and we ended up in, you know, somewhat similar places.
It is funny how some of those things have not changed in all those years.
No, well, ballet is just a very insular world that's very traditional. I mean, if you look at ballet, it's, you know, what are they doing? You know, it's like such a 19th century art, and it's very, very bizarre. And what I tried to do is figure out a way to modernize it and connect it with an audience, and but partly by showing the pain and the blood and the effort, so that people could appreciate that and understand that.
How many times was the company thrown at you as you were trying to finance the film?
The company, the Altman film,
and the box office it didn't do.
I didn't hear about that, but that had no genre at all. But that when I was working on the movie, I that film came out, and I did go to see it, and I was like, okay, good, I don't have to worry about it.
Not my movie.
Yeah, it didn't quite do much.
So thematically, for me, my reaction to the movie from the beginning was, this is not just about ballet; it's about actors, really, in a great. And I think as we go through the award season, that the actors will embrace this movie as their own, because it's so much about that experience of trying to figure out a role.
Yeah.
The pain of trying to figure out a role and all the, you know, everybody obviously has different steps and different events. Does your life, this is the inartful question of the day, but you have lived with an actress at times in your life.
Sure.
Affect what you came out with? Is there any process in terms of having to live with all that?
You know, I mean, my major collaboration is with actors. And so I'm fascinated by performance and what it takes to become, you know, to take on a role. You know, I think all directors, I have no interest to ever act. Mm-hmm. In fact, when I first started directing, I took an acting class only because I wanted to understand what it was to be an actor. And I made a goal for myself. I said, all I want to do is cry in front of an audience unconsciously, and then I'm done. And the day that happened, I quit. And I never had aspirations. I have no interest in it. Mm-hmm. But I just wanted to understand what performance was. Because, you know, as a director, you know, we're kind of these voyeurs of these performers. But we get to be up, really up close. And we get to see, you know, that transformation they make and that kind of, you know, when they do get into the moment, you know, I call it the Michael Jordan zone. You know, there's that famous photograph of him soaring during a slam dunk conference, and it's shot with a huge negative, and you see every single person in the stands in focus watching him, and you can look at all the faces, and every single face in there is having a religious moment, because they're basically staring at this unconscious moment of someone connecting with the unconscious universe, and it's a holy experience. It's like, you know, Mick Jagger, and you know, and so that's the closest we get. But for me, it's really interesting, people who get to do that for a living, and I think that experience is great. And I've had some actors already. Laura Linney at Telluride came over and gave me this hug that was just so intense. And so, you know, I do think actors will relate with it, not just because of what Natalie Portman managed to accomplish in this, which is, you know, really a tremendous amount of work and pain to get there, but I think it is about performance.
Well, Mickey went pretty deep undercover.
Mickey didn't go undercover at all. Mickey's the man. I mean, Mickey has more talent in his pinky fingernail than most of us get to, like, you know, ever in a lifetime. He's just so gifted and talented. He just sits there and it's just unbelievable to watch. He's just this maniac of talent. And so, you know, it's very easy for Mickey, you know. You know, so he's a very different creature than any of these other things, you know. But he did do some stuff. There were a few moments that actually didn't make this film. There's this kind of infamous, I don't know if you ever heard about it, there's this missing scene from The Wrestler, which is by far the most incredible moment of performance I've ever captured. But no one will ever see it.
Because?
I mean, Mickey wants to show it to the world, but it's kind of my, I'm holding it out so that I have one little piece of control over Mickey for the rest of my
life. You're waiting for his funeral, and it'll be on E.T.? Is that the...
he did some stuff that was just, it was just incredible.
And of course, now the last thing is, spoiler alert here for the, tell everybody spoiler alert.
Spoiler
the end
alert.
Of the movie.
Yeah.
I feel that she doesn't die.
Really?
Natalie is on the she doesn't die track. Barbara was definitely on the she's dead track.
Yeah.
Are you on a track?
What did Natalie say?
Well, she and I kind of went back and forth about it, but my take on it was that she grows up.
Right.
And that she's now matured, and even though she may be injured or whatever, but that it's not a literal death at the end of the movie.
Did Mickey die at the end of The Wrestler?
That we don't know. See, I wasn't even trying to guess that. He's just flying in the air. That's okay
with
me.
Right.
But it seems to me like this, the evolution is not to life and death, but to
womanhood.
To womanhood.
Yeah.
And Natalie actually did tell us that you told her that there was a reason why there was blood on her leg and not just on her stomach.
Yeah, I got to talk to Natalie about what she's saying on
She's
John
giving up your shit.
Oh, I got no comment on that.
You know, for me,
it's, you know, I mean, look, it doesn't really matter. I mean, the film's a fairy tale. It's a fever dream, and I don't think I know people want to explain and understand things and kind of, but I think that's the magic, is that there's a lot of ways to talk about it. And you know, I'll never forget in the moment I was outside a cafe when Pi first opened at the New Art in L.A. And some people walked in, and it was a father with a bunch of his daughter and her friends, and they were all talking about what the ending of Pi was, and it was the greatest moment in the world for me. So, I guess I'm addicted to that.
So this will be the talking about that will be the greatest moment in the world for you, being
Oscar
nominated for
it. I don't know. I just, you know, I think it's important that people have talk about what things mean, and because it reveals who they are and what their relationship is, and that. I mean, the worst thing you can have is when people go see a movie and they just go to the door and that's it, and they get back in the car and that's the end of their experience, you know. That's why we work really hard and serving up a rich meal, lots of layers, and let people figure it out, want to hear the music again and go out and buy the CD, hopefully want to see the film about again and think about it again, you know. That's what we're trying to do.
So confusing people versus Oscar nomination.
It's not confusing people.
How do you balance the two? Which is better? For you, which would be nicer?
I don't know. You know, I'm not good with those nomination things. I think I'm a little bit, we'll see what happens.
You've matured past that need.
Well, I've gone through it enough time. I mean, it's a beautiful thing, and it's really important for films like this to get that type of attention and get that type of focus. And it's great. It's very flattering and all that stuff. But, you know, they come every year. And, you know, I mean, I don't know how you do it every year. It's just got to drive you crazy. I guess it's interesting. It's fun.
Well, it's
fun.
Like joining a new circus every time.
It's a different set
of actors, and they're all doing different things, and directors, and films you love, and films that you think are overrated, and et cetera, et cetera. And
yeah, it's a good conversation piece.
You swim through it.
Yeah, absolutely.
And it makes a really good doorstop if you win.
Exactly.